So, warm good afternoon, all. Warm good afternoon, all.
Good
Yes, sir. So I welcome all the participants on behalf of SBCE, Department of Civil Engineering, for the last session of today's FTP program. So here today we have Dr. S. Praveen Kumar, Assistant Professor, PSU College of Technology, Coimbatore. So I'm very much glad to introduce Professor Dr. Praveen Kumar to the participants. So Dr. S. Praveen Kumar has obtained his BE Civil Engineering with Best Outgoing Student Support Award from Sri Krishna College of Technology. And he has obtained his ME Computer Methods and Application in Structural Engineering from Coimbatore Institute of Technology. And he has completed PhD in Civil Engineering at Anna University, Chennai. So his area of research includes concrete technology, fiber-reinforced concrete, microstructure analysis of construction materials, repair and rehabilitation of structures, earthquake analysis of structures, cost-effective housing systems, optimization techniques, and alternate construction materials. So he's a recognized supervisor for guiding PhD scholars at Anna University. And his area of research includes concrete technology, material characterization, and structural engineering. Sir is a lifetime member of professional bodies such as Institution of Engineers, Indian Society for Technical Education, Indian Concrete Institute, International Association of Engineers, Indian Society for Construction Materials and Structures, International Association for Automation and Robotics in Construction, Indian Association for Computational Mechanics, Indian Association for Structural Engineering. To his credit, he has published more than 15 papers in Scopus Index Journal with high impact factor. And he has also presented 15 papers in national and international conferences organized by reputed institutions like IIT, NIT, research labs, and etc. And he has attended various FTP short-term courses, workshops, and seminars. And he has received a grant of 2.75 lakhs from UGC under the Minor Research Project Scheme during the year for the period of 2017 to 2019 towards the project Synergic Effect of Agricultural Wasters on Mechanical Properties of High Performance Concrete. And he has also received grants from various government agencies such as CSIR, UGC for organizing workshops, seminars, FDPs, and training programs worth 5 lakhs. He is an institutional in setting up a laboratory named Advanced Concrete Research Laboratory at PSG College of Technology, Coimbatore, with advanced equipments to study the behavior of construction materials with different field applications. Currently, sir is guiding a PhD scholar. One student is pursuing PhD under his guidance, and he has guided a lot of PhD and UG projects, PG and UG projects. He has delivered more than 20 keynote lectures in FDP training programs, workshops, seminars organized with the various institutions in and around Tamil Nadu. And he is also a reviewer in reputed journals of Elsevier, Sage, and Springer publications. And he is also a guest editor and editor board member in the reputed journals in the field of civil engineering. So we are very happy to have you, sir, for today's program on Anna University-sponsored FTP program. So we welcome you, sir. Without further delay, I hand over the session to Dr. Praveen Kumar, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your long introduction.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I share my screen and then. Hope you are able to see my screen, right? Yes, madam. You are able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, it's visible.
Yes. My audio is clear right now.
Yes, sir.
So, good afternoon to all the participants over there. So, if any things happen at the back of the screen, you can intimate me by unmute your audio. So, my job today is to discuss about slope deflection method. So in analysis, maybe I'll be handling next three sessions tomorrow morning, afternoon and evening one session. So what I thought is, before going into deep into the slope deflection method, so we maybe I'll just tell you, because you will be with me for the next one day, how my sessions I have planned this. I'll be handling four sessions. So first session I'll be handling on introduction to structural analysis, where we'll be discussing about certain methods and loads that acts on the various structures like that. And the next session, introduction to SDM, that is slope deflection method. And then third session will be on continuous beam, and fourth session will be on frames. So I have planned for a quiz. In between, there will be a quiz which I will be posting it in your link, will be posted in your chat box in the Google form. And also, after completing in each session, maybe hardly of 45 minutes, we spend for 15 minutes of tutorial. So that exclusive tutorial hour can be eliminated, where in the regular hour itself, we can take the tutorial also. This is what the plan for next three sessions. So first session, today I'll be talking on introduction to structural analysis. So where my material, as per Anna University, they have given the reference of first reference is Structural Analysis 1 and 2 by Bhavishati. So my SDM part will be on reference from the this Bhavishati book, and introduction will be from the Hibbler. So normally we used to handle it from the Hibbler. So as per Anna University, I should not violate the reference. So I taken problems and other things from the reference. All PDF files I have sent to the organizers, so you can collect from them. And once again, going into the topic, I thank Madam for inviting to this lecture. Thank you, Madam. So we'll move to the lecture.
Praveen Kumar, yeah, just I went out for a meeting, so I've joined anyway. Yeah, please proceed. Yeah, thank you so much for accepting our invitation. Yeah,
thank you, madam. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, so what is analysis or a structural analysis? Normally, we plan and then we go for a design. So in general, we call it as a preliminary design, and then we do load calculations, and later on we do analysis, and we check with the serviceability and the safety in terms of some design, and then we go for a construction. If in the part of checking the serviceability or safety of a particular structure, if we say yes, then we go to the construction, or if it is not that much satisfied, then we have to go for a redesign of your structure. So obviously we all aware that how the design parts are supposed to be carried out, and in 1 and 2 of the Ananius syllabus we'll be discussing about a very minor part of structural analysis, where there are many methods that has to be taken into account in terms of advanced structural analysis also. So what is a real-time structure, and what, or we call it as a prototype, and how this prototype into develop into a model, and how it has been taken for an analysis. So you can see a picture where this is a real-time photo of a picture, where you can see the bridge with some supports, and the same is we normally call this as a, in structural modeling we call this as a prototype, and this is a model. So from this model, what we understand is a structure, when it is constructed or before constructed, we have to consider certain factors to be adapted in the structure, that is of load, temperature and other environmental conditions, which takes maybe in terms of materials, if you call, what is concrete behavior, how the concrete is evaluated, all those things have been taken into account before you do a design or analysis or consider for constructing a structure. So this has to be constructed in the form of a structure, that is what is highlighted, and we have to do some performance analysis, what are the stresses that developed, and how the stresses. For example, if you construct a three-story structure, how much load is to be taken into account by individual stories, and how the load has to be transferred, like that we have to think over it. So that and all we will see in the coming slides. So this is a basic understanding. So as we learn this analysis subject, what is our intention to be there to learn the subject is to ability to analyze the performance of a structural system under loads or any other external factors. And you are supposed to go for a understand and present yourself in the form of a result, and which can support the design of a structural components and the system. So for example, if it it is in the form of a components, beam or a column or a slab as a whole, connections, that is a beam column connection as a system, so we'll be able to understand its behavior and the performance and to conduct the laboratory test and validate. So as I told you in the previous slide, before, if you particular project with a very huge amount is invested, then we have to develop a model. It has to be tested in the laboratory and validate the results through various methods, and then understand the behavior. If there is any discrepancies that takes place between the test and the analysis data, then we have to rectify and we have to go for a prototype. That is the real-time structure. So this is a basic learning outcomes of an analysis subject. What generally we cover in analysis, in general, so classifications of structural forms, modeling of structural systems and structural elements and the determination of the loads. So obviously we all aware that everybody knows that we have to draw the shear force and bending moment diagram. So there are two kinds of structures we take into account. One is analysis of statically determined structure and the indeterminate structure. In determined structures, influence lines and their application. So in structural modeling, as I told you, this prototype and model, so influence lines and plays a vital role in developing this model and set how this be exact behavior in the form of a prototype. And in terms of analysis of your statically indeterminate structure, so approximate material of analysis, factor method and the force method, energy method, slope deflection and the moment distribution. So these are the topics which we normally cover in a normal analysis subject, not an advanced analysis. So in general, if you go for a determined structure, so we learn about definitions, Muller-Wendt principle, influence lines and the distributor loads. So then what are the influence line and how it is related to your design load, so and its application we learn. And if you go for a calculation of your deflection structure, we use various methods, so direct integration method, moment area method, conjugate beam method and energy methods. So maybe today morning you would have seen the energy method, strain energy method has been discussed. So it has its unique application, all these methods. For example, if you take moment area method, when you solve problems on flexibility method, so when you want to develop a flexibility matrix, you can use this moment area method or a conjugate beam method to solve integral of m by I into dx. So those things are very important in understanding the exact behavior of a particular element or a structure. For example, if you take a direct integration, so you can find a plane surface which is having a load at the center and where you can find an elastic curve based on the Bernoulli's equation, Euler's beam theory. So we all know d square y by dx square equal to m by ea. So d naught d theta by dx is equal to m by ea. So based on this, what is the plane of symmetry, and apply the boundary condition, develop the equation, and then finally calculate the solutions. In terms of moment area, we have first moment area theory and the second moment of area theory. As I told you, integral of m by a of dx. So here you will be theta equal to integral of m by a of dx, and here TAB equal to m by a of into d. So there are two methods. Based on the necessity and the requirement, you can apply any one of the moment area theorem and get the values of a particular solution. And this is a conjugate beam, so you can find the difference between your slope deflection and your load shear moment. That in case if you take m by ea in the slope deflection, where here it will be of w and theta v and y is of m, it's an actual beam, and where we in the conjugate beam it is of chain. So both are to be taken into account. So if you see this comparison, d theta by dx equal to m by a in slope deflection, dy by dx equal to theta, d square y by dx square equal to m by a in terms of load shear moment dv by dx equal to w dm by, that is moment which takes place, we consider as v, and double integration, double differentiation, that v square m by dx square equal to w. So this all a general part of doing some calculation with respect to various methods. As you are aware, today morning would have been discussed about this energy method, so virtual work principle. So it can be taken for a beam trusses, and then the frames for the beam, this is the general internal force that is developed, and this is the for the trusses and the for the frames. So work energy principle, so Cassler-Williams theory, Butts theory. So Butts theory in general, it is sigma pi del of q equal to, it's a big definition to say, but in a general equation it can be written like this. So similarly, if you go for Cassler-Williams theory, for trusses, what is your u value, for beams, what is your u value, for the frames. So just to highlight, these are the things which we have in analysis to discuss in detail about an application of any problems that has been considered. And for intermediate structures, so you have a portal method and the cantilever method. So everybody would have been undergone these kind of methods when it is for horizontal loads and for vertical loads. And these are the force methods. So we maybe you might be undergone some compatibility equation which is compared with your equilibrium equation. So first you have to choose the redundant force, calculate the deflection case by case, and then go for the superposition calculation. So for example, if you take this problem, a beam subjected to a point load at the center, so what should be your del B, like that you can calculate it and draw the primary structure. So it varies with the different methods and different problems that we undergo. It's an energy principle. So you can take a structure which is having a point load. So for this point load, what are the forces that is generated? So force that do work is dou u by dou p equal to del p, dou u by dou f equal to, where you, the force is, does not takes place at any account. So this is a general equation that we use for SDM, that is slope deflection. So anyway, we'll be detailly discussing about all this equations. This is a moment distribution. So what is your carryover distribution factor, fixed in moments, and then you have some procedures to do with the moment distribution. Okay. So in general, when we want to be a good structural engineer, so we want to motivate our students when we learn or when we teach some subject to them. So we have to conscious enough to tell what is the prerequisites, what should be the outcome of the subject, and what should be the future application of the subject. For example, from the first year till the last year, if they want to go for a postgraduate study also, we should be in the position to tell this one. So initially we will be dealing with the statics and dynamics, and then the mechanics of materials, normally we call it as strength of materials, and then analysis, then we do concrete design, and then steel design. So in analysis we use computer methods of analysis, that we normally call it as matrix methods of analysis with respect to flexibility and stress, and there are few special topics also available with the matrix methods of analysis. So finally we will be taking the central part of the construction with the different load conditions. So in terms, you can see all the lines that crosses in between has a unique kind of consideration with respect to the particular design, whether it may be a small structure or a big structure. The basic things that we understand is from your statics, dynamics, engineering mechanics, strength of materials, analysis, concrete design, steel design, then it comes to a complete package of good things, right? So this is a general observation which we normally made with respect to the subjects which we study in the undergraduate and the postgraduate level. So that's all about the first part of my presentation here, and then we will move to the next part, is types of structures and the loads that acts. So here you can have a tallest building and the longest span bridges. So why I have mentioned is tallest building, so we normally consider in all presentation we will tell law significance, right? So if I show you a residential building, you may not be able to understand or you may not be able to appreciate. So I have mentioned it as a tallest building and the long span bridges. The structure refers to a system of connected parts used to support a load. So what is the general understanding here is, if it is the tallest building, so you may be having a possibility of extending all kinds of analysis and design that has to be taken, whether it may be a concrete or a steel or a steel concrete composite, everything is to be taken into account. Similarly, in terms of large span also, we have some bridge conditions, right? Large span bridges, we'll able to know about your cables, arches, and the bridge constructions. So maybe these two buildings will give you an exact idea about the whole of your analysis and the design. So what is the classification of your structure is, beam structures, arch structures, trusses, domes and shells, columns and frames, and then, so if you take a member, the typical cross section which I have mentioned, it's a tie rod. So maybe when you learn your steel structures, you may be able to see in your tension members, angle section, channel section, rods, bars, and then the elements are this one. So we normally have different types of beams, can be simply supported beam, cantilever beam, fixed support beam, and the continuous beam. So this is a column, so this is a beam column which is subjected to have both axial and combined bending force. So in general, what are the general issues that we face with respect to a design or an analysis is how they are designed, how they are built, and how safe are they undergo with some environmental factors or natural disaster or artificial disaster. That is the thing which we want to understand before we do some design or analysis of a particular structure. So yeah, typical, as I shown you this in the previous first slide, a typical structure of a typical project for a structural engineering is, with respect to your this part is very important. So load evaluation and the analysis and the safety. So implementation, it will be there, but while implementation also we have to consider the material behaviors and during the implementation, whether the exact design is going to be implemented or all those structures to be built. But for that, we should be in the position to understand how this load is estimated and whether it is satisfying the condition of the requirement, and then whether it is having a safety aspect or the serviceability aspect, this has to be checked. So in this aspect, so what I am planned is to discuss about the structural loads. So maybe this may not be new to you, but just it is an sharing of the knowledge which I have. Dead loads are the loads that are permanent, so we are considering it as a fixed load. So always act vertically on the structure, self weight, the weight of the actual structure member. So superimposed, or we call it as the objects that are permanently attached to the structure, maybe of floors, roofs, and decks, and then concrete slabs, stationary equipment, and partition. So if all you are aware this one, live loads are the loads that change with time or can move. So example is the people who stays in the building and the furniture and the occupancy, or any kind of UDL, that is uniformly distributed load or point load on the top of the slab, movable equipment, or the snow or wind impact or earthquake. So these all forces, we call it as live loads, so which acts on the structures in different ways and different parts in the structure. Then we have a snow load. So snow loads are the loads developed due to heavy snowfall, the forces of snow on the roof. The loads, normally in our case we don't consider the snow loads, up to wind load only we consider. So it depends upon the kind of name which we use. So we use here, it is in the form of a wind load. So these are the lateral loads, that is nothing but your earthquake load. So wind loads, earthquake loads, and water, rainwater loads, and the soil. So there are other types of loads also available, I tell you in the future. So how this load configurations are made? So in general, the types of loads applied to the structures are in the form of concentrated loads, and then uniform loads, we call it as UDL, and the combination of this concentrated load and the uniform load, and there are certain possibilities of having varying load also. So what should be the exact action that comes out when this kind of load is applied in a structure is, so in this figure, here you have a compression, tension, bending, torsion, and then shear. So you may be asking whether all this forces are exactly taking place in any structural member. So yes, because when we do problem only, we assume that individual elements are designed and individual elements are placed, but when it is implemented in the structure, it will be connected with the structure, whether it is a beam or a column or a slab. So automatically, when it is subjected to some loading criteria, maybe all these actions maybe takes place, but with some duration it may be happening in the structure. So we have to be taken care of all these things. That too, if you take a steel structure, it will be very important to react with your compression, tension, bending, torsion. So mostly torsion we don't discuss with the steel, but in concrete we used to discuss, and then the shearing. So later on, the load parts that takes place is it's a general terminology which we use to describe the actual path that a load travels through the structural system. So every structure must have a load path to transfer the applied loads safely to the foundation. So you can see in the figure, so whatever the load that we calculate and it is supposed to be transferred to a particular structure, and it reach to the foundation and reach the soil safely, so that only we do some justice on the part of the designer analysis which we carried out for the particular structure. So in terms, you can see the figure. So these are the load that is transferred, and these are the members, that the elements that takes places. You can see a beam, column, footings, and the girder. So the typical load path for a multi-story building, here it is very clear. So floor, and then the beams, that is the primary beam, and the girders, and the secondary beam, and then columns. As I told you, it should reach the foundation and then finally to the soil bed. So in general, if you take this load criteria, the load criteria is very important in terms of your multi-story structure. So I can give you more details, but due to time, for example, if you select a particular site, you have to be in the position to take the soil samples to understand the safe bearing capacity. So based on the safe bearing capacity of the particular soil, we will define the type of a structure we are going to construct. Or based on the type of the structure, we have to modify the nature of the soil where we are going to construct. So it depends. It's a win-win situation which we modify on our requirement, but ultimately it has to be tested for your soil to know the safe bearing capacity. That it, now it is mandatory for all the structures to be constructed should know what is your SBC. So this is a typical underground car parking. So you're able to see, you maybe many used to say shear walls and all be placed to resist the lateral forces that acts on the underground. So normally we used to give some shear walls around to resist the lateral force that develops in the structure. Yes, so far we have discussed about the loads. So we will see what are the Indian load. This is a recollection for you people to know what are the Indian load standards that is available for the loading condition. So everybody knows we have a IS 875. So there are five parts which deals with all this kind. So one is dead load, live load, we call it as imposed load, and then wind load, slow loads, and we have a unique code which represents for the earthquake loads, and part 5 is the special loads and the combinations. Just it's a refreshing thing. So the first part of your IS 456 tells about your dead loads, the unique weights of the building materials and the stored materials. So can be taken, and so what the standards ensures is the minimum load designs to ensure the structural safety and economy. So the scope of this portal provision is all about your materials, so and the parts of the components that stored in the structure. So these are materials, what are the materials, building materials can be considered in the form of the unit load. So you can see bricks, cement, concrete, and then the various parts of the building with the as ceilings, agricultural products. So these are the stored materials. And coming back to the second part of the IS 875 is imposed load. So many used to tell what is imposed load. So in the code, it is clearly given it is not an imposed load. So code of practice for design loads other than the required loads for the buildings and the structures. So the minimum design values for this structural safety and economy. So which is of an exclusion of those who construction, acceleration and the braking condition. So in general, so this maybe in building regulation codal provision, you can understand what are the groups of buildings available based on that, how this nodal load condition is to be taken. So you can see here, these are the terminologies for residential building. So what is, if it is a, as I told you, if it is a UDL, so what is condition is live load. If it is a concentrated load, so what is the condition is, so this is based on the occupancy, it is classified. So based on the occupancy and the building, it is classified. So industrial building, assembly building, all these things has been classified. So next thing is this is of roof, based on the type of roof, flat sloping roof and the curved roof with the slopes, it has been classified. So for example, if you take a sloping roof, your UDL with the 1.5 kN/m², so this is imposed load and the dead load classification. So for example, non-permanent loads on the structure is supposed to be your live load, which has some magnitude and the time with respect to magnitude and the location change frequently with respect to the time. And we may not be able to predict it or estimate it correctly, but based on the condition of the codal provisions, we will so we have a factor. So factor will be used as per the limit state method. So based on that, we will be calculating the safer load of your live load. So that is what given. So it's a continuous loop. Since we discuss about analysis, I have shown this load distribution for the most adverse effect. So we can see that three span with a load of 100 kN in continuous beam, which has a bending condition. So this is a floor. You can find this in the appendix of your portal collection. Collection in the design for yes. This is a wind load, which is called as lateral load, or this is also named as a design load other than the earthquake for it. So it's a wind load calculation. So we all aware, we have six basic wind load speeds. So wind design, so fourth part is snow loads on the roof, and you have a typical codal provision which is revised recently, IS 1893 earthquake. So criteria for the earthquake reason, the recent code gives very clear idea, more details have been included in the recent code. So again, there are four zones have been classified. So we can able to see the seismic cases here. So part 5 is your special loads and the load time combinations. So that's all about first part, and then you have other loads. So as I told you, apart from this loads, you have other more loads to be taken into account. For example, hydrostatic soil pressure, basement in the multi-story building, temperature, so fatigue, construction, there are accidental loads that takes place, impacts, pollution, again. So there may be a blast, there may be a fire. So all this, if for example, if nearby people wants to construct a building, for that if they go for a boring, bore water, then automatically you will be able to find some difficulty in your substructure, which may not be able to observe on the superstructure. But there is a possibility of having some deformation in the substructure. So like that, with or without understanding, our structure may be subjected to different kinds of loading conditions. Yes, so this is all about loads. What are the load combinations? So we have dead, imposed, wind, snow, earthquake, temperature, soil pressure and blast. And if not, there are more loads that acts all to put together, but we have some restrictions with respect to our codal provisions. So not only that, only one particular or other combination should act. So simultaneously, we can able to see more combinations of load that takes place on the structure. So but if the combination has to be judiciously on keeping in the view of probability that there are actions together with the load, and it should ensure the safety and the economy. So as per your class 8 in IS 875 part 5, so the combinations are like this. So dead plus live, dead plus wind earthquake, dead plus T, and so there may be a possibility of change in the values with respect to your plus or minus based on the severity or the action that takes place in the individual loads. Yes, so these are just a review of your previous thoughts of having a structure with the different loading conditions. So now coming back to the analysis of statically determinant structure, so we will discuss what are the things that has to be required for a basic analysis. So we call it as idealized structure. So to model or idealize a structure so that the structural analysis can be performed, so you can see a real structure where it is represented in the form of an idealized structure. So that is, this is a real structure, then this is an idealized structure. So for example, if you take a support condition, so pin connection allows slight rotation, roller connections allows slight rotation or translation, fixed connection, fixed joint have allows no rotation or translation. So the typical roller support connection, this is this one, and the fixed support is this one. So this is a typical pin support, and this is a fixed support connection with respect to the material. So this is an condition. So like that, you can plan. So all these are in the form of a real. When you want to do this in the form of an idealized manner, see, you have a pin join, pin support. So pin join connected. So you have a fixed connected join. So you may be able to see these kind of figures in fibular. Maybe our books will have a different, not a colorful picture, the same picture, but not a colorful picture. It is already access to download is available for the Hitler. You can find it out. So torsional spring support, and you have a torsional joint. So like that, we call it as idealized. So for example, if you take in reality, all the connections and the supports are modeled with assumptions. Need to be aware how this assumption will affect the actual performance. So you can take an actual beam, which is applied with a load beam, and see the idealized beam and see how it is in the real time. So this is an exact idea about your conversion of your real structure to the idealized structure, where you can perform your analysis very simply. So for example, if you see the bottom three figures, rollers and associated bearing pads are used to support the precast bridges of a highway bridge. So similarly, there is a pin used to support the steel bridge of a railroad bridge, and there is a rocker support used for a bridge girder. So we have to assume all this support conditions in the form of an idealized way, where we need to go for some analysis process based on our requirement. So for example, if you take a light cable, weightless link, so how it is taken into account, roller or a rock, so we call like this smooth contacting surface, smooth pinned surface of these conditions will be taken like this, and a smooth pinned or hinged or will be taken like this. So this is just an understanding how the real thing is happened. So fixed connected collar, so how this is to be taken with respect to your force and the moment, and fixed beam support, so you have the condition. So idealized structure, so no thickness for the components. So the support at the A can be modeled as a fixer. So if you see an actual structure here, you may be able to see like a lamp post, where you have a column of length 4 meter and the beam of length 3 meter with the load that acts at the end of the beam. So a frame of structure A, B and C with the force at the end of the beam. So it's a simple pictorial representation. See, our students will not be able to aware of all these things unless we show them the figure and explain them the difference. And normally we draw these figures with us and directly we go for solving the problem. So maybe it will be attractive to them to see a real structure and see an idealized structure to understand the behavior very clearly, right? So since we are the framing condition, so we have seen the frame. Consider the framing used to support a typical floor slab in the building. The slab is supported by floor joists located at 11 intervals. So you can see here, there are in turn supported by two side girders, that is AB and BC. So you can find a girder and the column with the joists and the slab. So for this analysis, it is reasonably to assume that the joints are pinned or roller connected to the girder, and the girders are pinned or roller. So you can have a plan of like this, where you can able to solve the structure to be things. And what are the loading conditions? There are two ways in which the load on the surface can transmit to the various structural elements. One is one-way system and the another one is two-way system. So this is a typical example for one-way system. So you can see there is a structure where there is an idealized framing plan, and the idealized beam is taken and idealized girder is taken in a separate way to do the analysis. Similarly, if you go for a two-way structure, so we have a beam, idealized plan, and the idealized beam is there, right? So yes, that's all about the idealized structure which I want to discuss. And then the next basic thing is principle of superposition. So whenever we want to do any analysis, this should be known. So this is the first part where you have your point load and the usual, the tax and the number. So which is of x1, y1 of x plus y2 of x. So both are to be taken into separately, consider, and go for the application. So the total displacement at the point in the structure subjected to several external loading can be determined by adding together the displacement. So that is internal loading or the stress member that is to be taken into account, caused by the each of the external loads acting separately. So there may be a possibility of going for an extension. So taking the load to be a separate one, the linear relationship among the loads and the stresses. And two requirements for the principle to apply is, one, the material must behave in a linear elastic manner, that is Hooke's law has to be satisfied or it should be valid. The next one is the geometry of the structure must not undergo significant change when the loads are applied, when there is a small displacement theory. So this is a general thing which we normally assume with respect to the principle of superposition. So in general, everybody would have known with this one, equilibrium and the determinancy. For general 3D equilibrium, so we have sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, sigma z equal to 0, fx z equal to 0, and we have a moment sigma mx equal to 0, sigma my equal to 0, and sigma my. So it is for a 3D equilibrium. For 2D structures, it can be reduced to sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, and sigma m0 equal to 0. And so, for example, if you take this one, so you may be able to see how the forces are takes place. And for the point A and point B, so three equations are there, and we have three unknowns, that is sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, sigma m0 equal to 0. So similarly, so if you have a moment, so whether so structure is to make to be in the stable position, so whether this is not in the stable, no, it is not there. So three equation, three unknowns, but we don't have a proper support to be taken into account. So here, if you see, it is a stable one. So that there's four unknowns, one indeterminant. That is, for example, if you want to make this structure to be stable one, we have to go for a choice of redundancy. So make the choice of redundancy into account and solve the problem to make the structure to be in a stable position. So this is another case where we'll be discussing with the two conditions. So six equilibrium condition and six unknowns are there. So you can able to see F1, F2, and F4, F5, and F3. So A and B will be taken. In between, there will be F1, 2, 3, and 4, 5. So with the moment, so there will be six equilibrium condition and six unknown forces. So here, only you have, for this condition, you have only three equilibrium condition. And you may be able to see, take some point of, that is the moment, that four equilibrium condition and four unknown. So this is a general case. So maybe I explained a different way where normally we used to tell in the form of that is R less than or 3 or greater than like that. So in case if the equilibrium and the determinancy is to be known, if the reaction forces can be determined solely from the equilibrium equation, so we call it as statically determinant. So the number of unknowns that we is greater than that of the equilibrium equation, we call it as statically indeterminate. So it can be viewed in a local way or a global way via your free body diagram. So yes, I come to the same point. So determinancy and indeterminacy for 2D structure. So the number of components that was to be taken, that is R equal to 3N. So we I present a different presentation where a detailed based on the fixed end condition, how the static determinancy and time limit to this one, R equal to 3N, where N is your number of components and R is your number of unknowns. So R equal to 3N, R greater than R, 3N is statically indeterminate structure. And similarly, when you R minus 3 is a degree of indeterminacy that is taken. So additionally, that is EQs needed to be solved for the unknown, refer to the compactability. This comes under the stiffness method or compact, that is matrix method of analysis. We use to take these kind of things. So let us discuss the determinancy at this point. So statically determined, indeterminate to the in to the second degree. So like that, the problems are being solved with the determinancy condition. So these are the just an example problem. So to ensure the stability or equilibrium of the structure, so we must satisfy the equilibrium equations, and members must be properly held or constrained by their supports, and there is a unique set of values for your reaction forces and internal forces. So how we take the partial constraints are the pure reactive forces, then the equilibrium equations. So some equilibrium equations cannot be satisfied, then we call it as an unstable structure. So improper constraints. So you may be able to see these kind of structures. In some cases, unknown forces may equal to that of equilibrium equations. However, instability or moment of a structure could stable occur if support reactions are concurrent at their point. So it's an different conditions which we take the structure, but there are possibilities of making the indeterminate structure to be stable by choice of determinants, and then do the process of analysis by introducing the matrix method of analysis. This is a kind of problem where you have six reactions and six conditions. So you can see, so at the point B, it's an unstable one. So where you can see it's a stable one. So these kind of things has been taken. For example, if you take this problem, so you can able to see phi unknowns and phi equilibrium equations conditions. So there will be three global equations and two Hinge conditions. And we'll be seeing in the problem directly. So what is the equation that is generated with respect to three equilibrium conditions? So as of summary, this is an recollection. So I want to just recollect the basic things that is required to when we take this into account. So as a summary, we have discussed about the introduction part, that is structural analysis. What are the loads, structural loads? So we differentiated actual structure and the idealist structure, and the principle of superposition. So what are the equilibrium conditions for 3D structure, 2D structure, and how we did for analyzing your statically determined structure. So this is what in the presentation we have taken. So this is the first session I thought I could present, and we'll move to the next thing. Hope you all able to cope up, or there should be some more minimum time that is required to understand. Let me go with the other slides. Maybe I can clarify some doubts if they have anything with the general concepts. Yes, or shall we move to the SDM?
So participants, if you have any doubt, you can unmute and speak. So, okay, sir, we shall move to the next topic.
Yes. So, yes, exact content is this one. So, hardly we have half an hour of time. Now the time is 4:06. Maybe I think this require, okay, half the slide will be presented. Yes. So, we will be discussing about the slope deflection method introduction and then how this derivation carried out. So, this method was proposed by Professor John George in 1915. It is ideally suited to analysis of continuous beam and the rigid jointed frames. So the basic unknowns like slopes and deflection of the joints are found out here in this method. The moments at the ends of the member is first written down in the terms of unknown slopes and the deflection of each joints. So considering the joint equilibrium condition, a set of equations are formed. And the solution for this simultaneous equations gives you the unknown slopes and the deflection. So overall, all my presentation in the next three slides will be taken from this structural analysis tool by Bhavikati. So then the moment, end moments of individual members are determined, and then it involves a solution of simultaneous equation. A problem with more than three unknowns is considered as a difficult for a hand calculation. Hence, this method was laid down by the moment distribution method with the help of computers. So then the solution for any of number of simultaneous equation can be obtained earlierly. And then later on we move to the stiffness matrix method, so which is normally adapted for analysis of large structure with the help of computer. So mostly in general, we'll be considering all the problems related to large or any software-based problems. Software, they use only matrix method of analysis. Maybe I think that you will be discussing a determined structure by using this kind of stiffness method. Matrix. So what are the assumptions we made here is, we made all the joints are rigid. Rotation of joints are treated as unknowns. Between each pair of supports, the beams are between each pair of the support, the beam section is constant. Joint in the structure may rotate or deflect as a whole, but the angles between the members meeting at the joint remains the same. I will explain you a few important assumptions clearly. So the distortion or the deformation due to the axial conditions are neglected. The shear deformations are neglected. So first point is all joints are rigid. That is, the angle between any two members in the joint does not change even after the deformation during the loading. Thus, at the joint A in the figure, the angle between the members AB and BC remains. So for example, if you say the figure, so you have a joint A. So the joint A in the figure, the angle between the members AB and the BC remains in the theta, which is after application of your load, it also remains in the same position. So there will not be any change. So we assume all the joints are rigid and the distortion due to the axial deformation are negated. For example, if you see here, there will be a change in the position of B to B dash and C to C dash. So with the length, or we call it as a del deformation or a deflection. So these axial deformations is neglected initially. So in general, for the next two presentations, the sign conversion we use is for moments anti-clockwise positive and clockwise positive, anti-clockwise negative. And the rotation, clockwise rotation is positive, anti-clockwise is negative. Settlement, right side support is below the left side support, that is positive. Left side support is below the right side support is negative. So the moments clockwise is positive, anti-clockwise is negative. So for example, if you see this picture, for the moment, MBA is 20 as of the figure, and MBC is of minus 20. That is, in the anti-clockwise direction, it is minus 20, and in the clockwise direction, it is plus 20. So similarly, if you go for a rotation, the theta 1 and theta 4 are positive rotation, and theta 2 and theta 3 are negative rotations in the figure. For example, you see the angle between this theta 1 and theta 2, this one is positive and this one is positive, where this theta 2 and theta 3 is negative. That is, rotation in the clockwise is positive and anti-clockwise is negative. So similarly of settlements, so you can see a figure where both ends are fixed. So the length of AB of L1 and BC of L2, which has undergoes a deformation. So AB of del is positive, for the BC the del is negative. So the left side support is below right. Left side support is positive. Left side support is below right side support is negative. So it is in general. So what normally I used to tell is, in general you can assume clockwise in rotation or moment, or in any way clockwise will be positive and anti-clockwise will be negative. So that's the case. If you solve problem, it will be easy. So before entering into the subject, so some keywords to be understood clearly. So what do you mean by initial fixed end moments? So initial fixed end moments is moments at the end of restrained member due to the loads or the support is called as initial fixed end moments. So you may be aware that FEM. So FEM is a common term used here in the derivation, in problems, in books. Every books they use FEM. Similarly, shrinking of support or settlement of support. So lateral displacement of one end of the member with respect to the another. So if there is a change, for example, if a continuous beam was of having A, B, C, D, so you may be having a B, A, B of a point load, B, C of a UDL, C, D of a varying load, but there may be a possibility of there settlement of supports at B position to 5M. That is what given here in the form as lateral displacement of one end of the member with respect to the other end. This causes the moment at both ends of the member. So side wave. So lateral displacement of end of the columns, which includes moments at the both ends depending upon boundary conditions. So we'll be discussing about the frames with slave and without slave. And we normally call it slope deflection equation. So equation relating the final moments at the end of member with initial moments due to the loads and the deflection. Understand clearly. So anyway, we'll be next slide, I think we'll be deriving this equation, how this is done, and then yes, madam. Okay. Yes, sorry. Yes. So, slope deflection equation. The equation relating final moments at the end of the member with the initial moments due to the load and the deflection. For example, this is a slope deflection equation. For a continuous beam, we'll be deriving this equation. And then equilibrium equations. Algebraic sum of moments at the joints equal to the zero should be satisfied. So this is a common condition that we have to adapt it, where your condition of equilibrium is getting satisfied with the problem. So maybe you can call this as a keyword or a steps we are going to follow here. And then finally, in terms of frames, we follow a terminology called as shear condition. This is an additional condition to compute unknowns in the case of slave, which states the summation of horizontal forces, that is the force reaction at the supports and the lateral loads of any particular column level is zero. So there may be a possibility of having some slides. There may be a possibility of having change in the angle of a particular column. So that is what about keywords. So these are the, once again I will repeat, so we'll be dealing with this terminologies again and again in the next two sessions or three sessions. Initial fixed end moments, shrinking of supports, side waves, and then the slope deflection equation and the equilibrium condition and the shear condition. So maybe I think this derivation part I will take tomorrow, because now we have to wind up at 4:30. Because it will take another 25 minutes to do the derivation. Before that, I will go for this application. So application of your slope deflection equation is, so rigid jointed structures can be analyzed. continuous beam can be done, and then the frames without sideways, that is non-sway condition, and without with the sway, that is the side sway condition. So in general, the steps to be followed for analysis is computation of your fixed end movements. The formula for fixed end movement, that is, we call it as FEM, that is actions for the various load conditions. So next slide, we have a table. The sign conversion followed is that the moment, as I told you, clockwise is positive and anti-clockwise is negative. So these are the figures. Maybe in continuous beams also, I taken only very few parts of this fixed end movements for better understanding. So this is a general case where we have a different beams of different conditions. For the first one is of point load in a different position of your location, that is AAB. So you can see this first image. Sorry. Yes. So this is a point load that is applied, and you have a moment. So there is two point load that operates between the loading condition, and you have a UDL, full UDL, half UDL, varying load, and there is a deformation that takes places. There is, so all these things we will be discussing in the continuous beam and the frames. Based on the requirement, we will be finding the fixed end movements. And the next step is relate the member end movements to the joint displacement. So the end movements are as follows. So we'll be deriving this end movements in the next tomorrow morning hour. So generally what we call it as is MAB equal to 2EA by L into 2 theta A plus theta B plus 3 del by L plus FM of AB. That is the fixed end movement. So similarly of MBA equal to 2EA by L theta A plus 2 theta B plus 3 del by L. So in few books you can able to see del by L will be considered as psi, or some other notations will be given. So 3 del L by L. So like that you can see this point, this part alone will be taken in a different way. So psi will be there, and this will be considered as G, and in some books you can able to see this one. So compute the end moments for each member using the expression. So this is the equation called as slope deflection equation, right? The next one is formulate equilibrium equation. These are obtained by making algebraic sum of moments at each joint as zero. In case of frames with sway, additional equations are obtained considering the shear condition. So that is what I told you initially in the keywords. We use a new terminology called shear condition when it comes to the sway. So that we will discuss during the time of discussing about the wave. So we have to formulate the equilibrium equation based on the slope deflection equation. Then on next one is solve the equation. So this will be giving you a displacement, that is a initial unknowns, that is theta A, theta B, and the del values known. So on the next step is back substitution. So whatever the values that we calculated in the step B, in the expression for the end moments found in the step B, substitute the values of known displacements as obtained in the step D, that is solve the equation. You will be getting the equilibrium condition equation. This gives the final end moments for each form. So from this, the support reactions can be calculated. So now you can go for the sketch of drawing the shear force and the bending moment. So I think we'll stop with this. If any doubts, you can ask. We have 10 more minutes of time for discussion. Since if I start this derivation part, it will take around 20 minutes of time to complete. So I think we'll stop with this and we'll continue the tomorrow's class, right? So any doubts you have, you can ask. Yes, madam, if you can ask some faculties.
Yes, sir. Dear participants, if you have any notes, you can
add them. Many people are known to me here. Prabhu is my student. Many are there. Prabhu? I don't know. Many are known. Yes, madam, you can
So dear participants, if you have any doubts, you can unmute yourself and ask. Otherwise, you can type it in the chat box.
So if there are no questions, I think we can continue the session tomorrow, because tomorrow's first session up to third session will be handled by Dr. Ravi Kumar. So I think he'll be going in depth on the slope deflection method from tomorrow onwards. So any questions from the participants? Let us conclude the session, Dr. Satya, in that case. So let us conclude the session with the group photo. So I request the participants to switch on your video for the group photo session along with the resource person. Is it done, Satya?
Yes, ma'am, it's done.
Okay, thank you. So thank you all. So participants, as please see the message in the chat box of our WhatsApp group. So today, so I've sent the list of final participants list via Anna University Center for Faculty Development. Okay. So thank you all. So we'll meet tomorrow 9 o'clock. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Praveen Kumar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, dear participants.